Probably in about 2 weeks, there's a British embassy military briefing. I'll let you know when I'm back.
By then?
Already ready for the season.
Good morning, how are you?
I'm going to
Can we turn this off?
Oh.
Because
How do you record things? And
is it the same thing as
no, I have no sharing.
Okay, good.
Every time we talk, it's time. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning. Thank you for joining us for today for our conference on security, South Caucasus Security Forum. I'm delighted to announce that we have a special guest, special speaker for today, Minister of Foreign Affairs of Georgia, His Excellency Nikhail Chernyavidze. On behalf of the Bulgarian Foundation and Strategic Policy Institute, our partners, our partner organization, allow me to express my special appreciation to His Excellency for accepting our invitation to deliver a speech at our conference. We are especially grateful, as all of us know, that there is a high level of Bulgarian delegation visiting the country. Thank you, Minister, and the floor is yours.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, excellencies, dear guests. First of all, I would like to thank Rondelli Foundation and organizers for inviting me as a keynote speaker in this forum, truly important event. to share views and visions on an issue that has a crucial significance considering vibrant developments and challenges in the world and in our region. This conference and this forum has become a tradition, a very good tradition, and it provides a good opportunity to discuss in Georgia with Georgian experts and international experts these very important issues. Unresolved regional conflicts attempts to destabilize regional security, wars in Syria and Iraq, mounting threat of terrorism and spread of weapons of mass destruction pose serious challenge for the countries of the region and stability and security of Europe as a whole. We saw the activities of ISIS in Europe, and tragedy again in France. I'd like to express condolences for the family of the killed policeman. France has been in a state of emergency since 2015, and we see how ISIS has affected the lives of innocent people and the political life of European Union, Europe, and all of us. So it's a daily threat which we need to tackle together and defeat together. And we stand united with French people, and we stand united with all the people fighting this biggest challenge of today. One of the main tasks of the Georgian government is to effectively counter a wide range of threats and create a safe, democratic, and economically promising environment for all citizens. The security means not only keeping safe the country from an external aggression or other security risks, but also to strengthen democratic institutions, guarantee political and personal freedoms, provide economic opportunities for everyone. All these dimensions of security require good governance and basically trickle down to our European and Euro-Atlantic choice. This is why Georgia, despite attempts of intimidation, has been pursuing this path. A significant achievement in our EU integration agenda affects the European and Protestant choice, with the overwhelming majority of the Georgian population standing by this choice. Nevertheless, we cannot deny that conventional security remains a major issue for Georgia. Continued militarization and attempts to annex the occupied territories of Georgia is a serious threat and significantly contributes to the instability of the region. The Georgian territory is being crisscrossed by barbed wire fences, deteriorated human rights situation, for example, legal discrimination of ethnic Georgian population, as well as kidnappings and provocations along the occupation lines that usually occurs, unfortunately. The recent agreement on the creation of joint Russian and US military force and referendum in Skinwala region serve as yet another example. In this context, we are grateful for the support of the international community, including international organizations and our partner countries, to address these challenges. Two days ago, there was a consolidated report of the Secretary General of the Council of Europe presented for the review, and it was supported by all members of the Council of Europe except Russia. And we highly value and appreciate this very strong support and consolidated support of international community and society against the aggression of the Russian Federation, against the provocations they are making here in Georgia, and supporting the peaceful conflict resolution process, which is a firm belief of Georgian people, Georgian government, and we are committed to finding constructive and peaceful ways for conflict resolution and ways of solving the conflict in the frames of international law and international principles. We are happy that the international community is committed to upholding the international laws and principles. At the same time, despite all these developments, we continue the process which leads us to more engagement with the people living in the occupied territories. We are ready and interested to offer all the benefits of European integration and diplomatic integration to all people living in on the Georgian territory, including the occupied territories, and we will continue this path. We will continue providing all these benefits, and we will continue strong process of reconciliation, engagement, and confidence building. At the same time, despite all these developments in occupied territories, we also see the threat from not only international threat, but also threats coming from employing soft power and propaganda. We see some active words of different organizations trying to impact on Georgian society, but Georgian community is very strong and very firm in its European choice, because this is the only choice. This is the only choice to become part of the free society, to become part of the free world, and to create a sustainable future and a stable future for our new generations. Georgia, unfortunately, is not the only one facing the problem of anti-Russian propaganda. In recent years, we saw the significant growth in threats and challenges of information warfare against the countries of Eastern Partnership region and wider Europe alike, even in the Western European countries. This necessitated the strengthening of overall media and communication environment, both in Georgia and in NATO EU member states. And it also dictates us to improve our capacity to focus, address, and respond to disinformation activities. This implies intensifying interactions with media development of communications and public diplomacy programs for certain important groups like academic and educational circles, youth and opinion leaders, in order to reach out and inform as wide a public as possible of the positive narrative and discern their fears and ignorance. The special emphasis is put on the growing threat posed by sabotage or terrorism via cyberspace, which can seriously influence proper functioning of any state. In this regard, we have unfortunately very bad experience came during the Russia-Georgian War of August 2008, when Georgia became a victim of an intensive cyber attack. But after that, there are many of these kind of examples around the world. The lessons we learned demonstrated that any type of cyber attacks may have a considerable effect, and we need to find relevant measures against these threats. Dear participants, The threats I mentioned above represent challenges not only for Georgia. They countered effectively, they can be countered effectively only by common efforts, when time for individual and isolated approaches must be left behind. In this context, elaboration of the EU's global strategy for foreign and security policy was very important. Georgia tried to play a very important role in the elaboration process. We participated and contributed at full extent possible. And for the first time in the history of Georgia, the country was mentioned in the EU strategy as a stable and democratic state that is one of the key partners of the EU in the region. In these difficult times, it is of utmost importance to stand together, and therefore our willingness to contribute to the common security and defense and improve cooperation in areas of mutual interest, such as anti-terrorism, fight against organized crime, cybersecurity, CSDP cooperation, and so on, comes as a very important contribution from our side, and it's in our joint interest. It is in the national interest of Georgia, and it is in the interest of the security of Europe. We are part of the European order, we are part of the European security, and we are ready to contribute to that as much as we can. We are a small country, but we can march about our ways. We show this to the whole world and international community already with our contributions, and we are ready to continue doing that. Despite more than a fair share of challenges of our own, continue these contributions, not only to NATO missions, but also to the EU missions, including the EU-led mission in Central African Republic, and some other CSDP missions. Yet another good example of how to respond to emerging problems arising from international organized crime and terrorism is recently signed agreement with Europol on operational and strategic cooperation, which aims to expand cooperation to combat serious and organized cross-border criminal activities, and allows for the exchange of information, including the personal data of suspected criminals, and joint planning of operational activities. We are interested in deepening defense and security partnership with the European Union. It is one of the upcoming issues on our bilateral cooperation agenda with the European Union. We have that format already in mind, and these ideas have been shared with our European counterparts, and we look forward to a different cooperation in all these areas. I would like to underline importance of more active involvement of, first of all, NATO, as well as European Union in peace and partnership, and especially in the Black Sea region, which is a crucial factor for ensuring stable and peaceful development of countries in the region. We are also very much interested to contribute to Black Sea security, and we welcome NATO's forward increased presence, which is oriented on ensuring the stability of the Black Sea. Black Sea connects us with the European Union. When we talk about the political and legal institutional approximation with the EU, the real integration will not happen if we will not be physically integrated with the European internal market. Therefore, Black Sea remains a very important sea and a way for full-fledged integration into the EU internal market. We need stability on the Black Sea, and we assure that NATO's forward presence and presence on the Black Sea will ensure this stability. We are ready to contribute to the Black Sea security, and we already are participating in the discussions, and we welcome the decision of the Warsaw Summit, NATO, to include Georgia in the enhanced dialogue on the Black Sea security. We continue our very successful integration process in NATO. Our agenda with NATO is very active. This year has started with many good events already. We had several NATO-Georgia commissions held. We had visit of the military committee to Georgia. We are now going to host the NATO Parliamentary Assembly and NATO's Secretary General again in Georgia. And we are actively implementing the very important package, NATO-Georgia Substantial Package, which strengthens Georgia, strengthens our defense capabilities, resilience, and advances our path towards membership into NATO. We all together, by common efforts only, are capable to overcome all problems we face, and Georgia is ready to continue to be a reliable partner for the EU, for the NATO, but not only the partner. We are going and ready to do everything in order to be full-fledged members of both organizations, NATO and the European Union. It is the future of Georgia, and it is the future of stable and secure European Union and our region. Thank you very much.
Your Excellency, thank you for your keynote address, for your insightful speech, sharing with us your thoughts and considerations. We really appreciate your participation. This is a demonstration of the openness of your ministry to cooperate with expert society, as well as emphasizing the need of discussion and importance of discussions about the stability and security in the South Caucasus. Thank you. And with this, I would like to announce a 5-minute break to the Sun of Greece and the room.
and then focusing on Georgia. The invasion of the EU and Georgia in the framework of the security policy, and because this is the subject that I know best. And we start by saying that the EU global strategy adopted last year was for sure one of the most significant policy papers adopted by the EU in the past years. It should be read in connections with other documents which are also relevant to it. In particular, the implementation plan for security and defense, which was presented by the High Representative to the Foreign Affairs Council of the European Union at the end of last year, and the Commission European Defense Action Plan, and the follow-up to the joint declaration signed in Warsaw by the President of the European Council, the President of the European Commission, and the Secretary General of NATO. And let's have a quote from Federica Mogherini forwards that the EU global strategy will guide us in our daily work towards a union with the strength to contribute to peace and security in our region and in the whole world. Indeed, the strategy extensively covers the EU neighbors, the South and East, acknowledging the strategic priority of state and societal resilience in the neighborhood to counter both internal and external challenges. And the strategy states three priorities which are of relevance for the Eastern Neighborhood Partnership region. As I said, the state and society resilience, an integrated approach to conflicts, and cooperative regional regional borders. In setting out these priorities, the EU intends to pursue its comprehensive approach to security, including the focus on human security. And it's important to mention that a wide array of EU instruments have been successfully rebranded, focusing precisely on stabilization and resilience building roles, at the same time improving defense capabilities and response mechanisms to different threats has become lately one of the core items of the EU internal agenda and are being discussed with Eastern European partners in bilateral as well as in the multilateral formats. The EU supports the Eastern Neighborhood Partnership regional countries through helping the implementation of the association agreements, including deeper comprehensive free trade areas. And think about deepening tailor-made partnerships further through, for example, the extension of trans-European networks and the energy community. Society links will also be strengthened through enhanced mobility, cultural and educational exchanges, research cooperation with civil society partners. Full participation in EU programs and agencies is also important too, and further involvement in CSDP missions, which was mentioned by the Minister, will also play an important role. Now, on resilience, which is a key word of the strategy, there are some words on this. Fragility beyond the EU borders threatens the EU vital interests, and by contrast, resilience, which means the ability of states and societies to perform, withstanding, standing and recovering from crisis, benefits both the EU and our neighbors. A resilient state is a secure state, and security is key for prosperity and democracy. And according to the global strategy, the EU will support different paths to resilience, focusing on the most acute dimensions of fragility and targeting those where we can make a meaningful difference. And when we come to Georgia, first of all, we should mention that Georgia is one of the few countries which is explicitly mentioned on the strategy. The strategy says that Georgia
is a key country in the region whose successful transformation can reverberate positively across the region. So the strategy recognizes Georgia as a prosperous, peaceful, and stable democracy in the region. And through an ambitious association agreement, Georgia is directing its reform efforts towards political association and integration with the EU, which is in full progress. Visa liberalization has been a significant added value to Georgia's transformation and modernization process. In the region, the EU and Georgia share strategic interest in developing transport corridor for trade and energy linking Europe with Central Asia and Caspian region. Furthermore, Georgia remains a key ally of the EU in the security sector, inter alia by contributing to EU crisis management operations, fight against terrorists, as well as NATO and peacekeeping operations, thereby continue contributing to the Euro-Atlantic and global security. Furthermore, the EU plays a crucial role in promoting peace and security in Georgia through the USR active role in Geneva international discussions, active non-recognition and engagement policy, the presence of a large monitoring mission, so international mechanisms present on the ground. We see the opportunity for our cooperation in security further growing and becoming a true partnership in this area. A few weeks ago, we signed an operational agreement between Georgia and Europol, which was mentioned by the minister as well, which will increase our capacity to effectively trade with common threats like terrorists, transnational organized crime, trafficking in people. As the minister also mentioned, we are engaged in a consultation to see what the most appropriate format for this cooperation would be, what the agenda would look like. And there are, for us, three issues which are mentioned in the global strategy, which are cyber security, energy security, and strategic communications, which the office will be included in a list which is not exhaustive of the agenda that we could launch in the coming months. But I stop here.
Thank you, dear Carlo. We are very grateful for all the support you provide to Georgia. I repeat the development of democracy and the resilient states really will support stability in the region. At the same time, I think that keeping the EU in that process going on is also important. It really could strengthen the EU and give additional impetus to partner countries as well. But to return to the global strategy, so the keywords for the strategy are resilience and at the same time development. This is kind of new approach to security. I would love to tell us about the strategy.
Thank you very much. And thank you to the organizers for inviting me to this conference. It's always great to be in Georgia. I'm going to try and be quite short. I have 6 points, and hopefully they're quite short as well. I mean, first of all, I think the global strategy is much more fundamental than its predecessor in the security strategies of the past. In terms of the external dimension, you can see that there's been a shift away from the language of democratization towards this now buzzword resilience. I mean, resilience is used throughout the entire document where you used to have democratization. Resilience is then now. Now, my first point is about the conditions under which this document was actually written. Because if you look back, I mean, it was done during a time when the EU was facing numerous crises. And most of these crises were and still do undermine security. And it's a long list. I mean, first of all, obviously, the Eurozone crisis. And then this was followed by the migration crisis, to which the EU didn't have an answer itself, so it basically outsourced it to Turkey. Then there's the issue of the growing problem of terrorism, the rise of ISIS, which led to an increase in jihadist radicalization throughout many, many EU member states. And then the majority of these member states weren't prepared for this challenge. There was very little, you know, cooperation between them, and they're only just now starting to get to grips with it. Then the old, you know, the old friend, the Russians, which have been a challenge to our security now for, you know, several years. Of course, the traditional challenge of Russia has been exacerbated by the hybrid challenge of Russia, because it was really the Russians that brought this hybrid issue back onto the table. And then, of course, the rise of the far right, the anti-EU agenda and the anti-Muslim agenda that came with it. So these are key challenges. These have been exacerbated, of course, by Brexit, by Donald Trump, and I would say as well by the worst crisis that the EU has ever faced with Turkey, which still has no answer to it. And again, we have on the highlight coming up the French elections, what's going to happen there. It can also have a huge impact on the security situation. Second point is, you know, the aim of the global strategy. It says the aim is to enhance resilience and security from within, while increasing the capacity to counter external threats, you know, better understanding of strategic vulnerabilities. And there's four buzzwords which appear in this document. The one that I've mentioned already, resilience. The second one, which is principled pragmatism. And the third one, which I probably like the most, which is called, you know, connecting the dots. Because you hear around Brussels now this term, we have to connect the dots, we need to connect the dots. Even in the think tank where I work, we're told every week in our staff meeting, well, we need to connect the dots between the different programs. And then the fourth one is the integrated approach. When it comes to the neighborhood, the EU wants to have a stable and predictable neighborhood that will not export threats. We can't say that it's actually achieved this up until now, because in fact, it pains me to say this, but the more engagement the EU's had in its neighborhood, the more unstable and predictable it has become. But we know that's not because of the EU policies itself. This is because of the blowback from the Russians. And the strategy, you know, underlines this new differentiated approach, which recognizes different realities on the ground, which is a good thing, because this didn't exist before to that sort of degree in the, you know, European neighborhood policy and Eastern Partnership. And the society and states need to be more resilient to both internal and external threats. But I mean, to me, it's not exactly clear who exactly the EU is trying to make resilient. Because if you're making a state more resilient, that's fine in some cases. But again, it depends on the state. Because perhaps the societies of some states, because I'm not going to mention their names, perhaps won't appreciate that particular leadership being made more resilient. So that could be slightly problematic, but I mean, it's clear to me that this whole resilience issue needs to have lead from a bottom-up approach. It shouldn't be top-down, it needs to be bottom-up, there needs to be a very strong focus related to civil society. It also implies that when, you know, the common interests are there, or an interest between the partner state and the EU collide, the EU is going to work with repressive partners, and of course this is also something that's questionable. Point three is related to security, because clearly, you know, a resilient neighbourhood needs to be a peaceful one. It's hard to bring about resilient states when the neighbourhood is stuck in a state of almost permanent conflict, either because of internal issues or external issues. Now, the EU has committed itself to be more engaged in security issues, to give more support, for example, to the protracted conflicts, trying to resolve them. I mean, we just heard that this would be done in a multilateral framework using, you know, cooperation with different organizations. But this happens already. I mean, in my view, I mean, the EU has been happy to outsource or to allow, you know, the OSCE in particular to take the lead in, you know, conflict resolution. We've seen this in the Horn of Karabakh, for example. The EU still remains, in most cases, you know, a periphery actor. Obviously, in Georgia, it has a stronger role, and in Moldova, but I mean, in the Karabakh conflict, it doesn't really play a role at all. And in the conflict in Ukraine as well, the EU itself, you know, isn't really engaged. I mean, it's Germany who's always taking the lead role, and I think this is a mistake. I mean, the EU is a foreign policy actor and should be engaged in the conflict in the Donbass. And also, you know, I think the agreement that the EU signed up to, you know, the Minsk Accord itself, I mean, it's a heinous agreement, I'm sorry to say, it's unimplementable. So I think, you know, there needs to be a new look at the role that the EU can play in Ukraine in terms of the Minsk agreements and going forward. The other issues, of course, are that the EU has committed a security sector reform capacity building in these areas. But again, that very much depends on which state you're dealing with and to what degree they're going to allow that to happen and what will be the actual outcome of these security sector reforms. Because in some countries, I mean, the police or the security services are very loyal to the president, which can have, you know, let's say, different outcomes. Strategic communication is obviously, you know, a huge, huge, huge challenge and hugely important to counter Russia propaganda. And I think it's excellent that we now have, you know, Stratcom. But again, you know, I feel that it doesn't have the sort of necessary capacity yet. It needs to have a much larger capacity to be able to carry out its role sufficiently, because I don't think we can underestimate the actual danger of Russia propaganda. But again, this comes down to member states being ready to politically contribute or to support, you know, the enlargement of the team who are responsible at Stratcom. And then you have cyber security, border security, CSDP missions. I think these are all, you know, very important. But again, it very much depends on the willingness of the different partner country. Obviously, it's not going to be a problem for Georgia, because Georgia wants more EU, probably all over the place than some of the others. I also think, you know, there's an issue here for the countries, because the countries, I mean, the governments, you know, the issue is national survival, and these states are looking for external military support and security guarantees, crucial things. And of course, at the moment, if ever, the EU is not in a position to give any of these, which is a shame, but I don't think this is actually going to change very quickly now, because I know I'm being too long. The hybrid threat, I mean, the countering this across the region is absolutely crucial. But this can't be done with one tool, because the response to hybrid also needs to be hybrid too. So all the tools available need to be brought together in, you know, in this famous slogan again, the joined up approach. And of course this includes, you know, cooperation with NATO and other international organizations. But I think this is, you know, this is really important. And very lastly, just a last couple of points. First of all, on the Russians. I mean, the EU still needs to find an effective way to deal with Russia. They don't have an effective approach yet. Whether we will ever have one remains to be seen. Hopefully we will. But in the Black Sea area in particular, I mean, Russia has constructed this integrated security structure that goes from the Black Sea to the Caspian Sea, and then down to Syria. This didn't exist before, and it was talked a lot about yesterday, so I'm not going to say too much about that. But I think, you know, this is very dangerous, frankly speaking, for the security of the whole region. And as we, you know, sit around discussing how we can counter that, the Russians are busy reinforcing, you know, that structure, reinforcing in consolidation the military bases already have in Georgia, in Crimea, and of course in Armenia. They're wasting, you know, no time. And the last point is actually about the long-term vision of the EU, because I don't think there exists still any clear vision that the EU has for this whole region. And in terms of that, I mean, when the EU is busy building, trying to build, you know, resilient states, what is the actual outcome or the goal of this resilient, of these resilient states? I mean, is it so that one day these resilient states are so integrated with the EU, they can integrate with the EU and become a member? Or is it simply because the EU wants to create a buffer zone that would make these countries, you know, resilient to threats, and so they wouldn't pass on these threats to the EU? So in a way, you know, the Russians, you know, want this region to be, you know, a buffer zone, because they've always viewed it as a buffer zone or a beachhead against security threats. Is the EU also looking for, really looking for a buffer zone rather than future members, also to protect it from threats? Although obviously these are real threats, not the artificial threats that the Russians have in their heads. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Amanda, for your comprehensive view on the challenges that we have in terms of security and stability in the region. I fully agree to your bottom-line approach to strengthen resilience, because I really think that development of democracy is the most important, especially in making the states more resilient in terms of security a lot. But is the support to provide influence to the neighborhoods enough to make the states really resilient? Yes, probably it is important, but we could see a little bit more. And that's why we're speaking about some new instruments of assistance. Some maybe increased assistance as well, in order to really set and state institutions and really develop economic capabilities of the countries. At the same time, is the EU strong enough to persuade its interests in the region? What are the weaknesses of the EU coincide? You know, could you speak
a little bit about this? Yeah. Just want to thank you for being nice to me, it's great to be here, of course. And it's great also to listen to the foreign minister who had this message that Russia, Georgia is on its way towards Euro-Atlantic integration, that this is the only only game in town. And that Georgia wants to be a full-fledged member of the EU and NATO. So it's a little bit impolite to put some water into the wine, but I think as we speak about the EU global strategy, there is little in the EU global strategy that would support this, this idea or this approach. The global strategy makes clear that under the headline, enlargement, there's only Balkans and Turkey, and I think we have enough signals as well from the Juncker Commission that this is the game is not so much enlargement for Eastern neighborhood. Georgia has mentioned it, but under the headline neighbors, and resilience obviously also plays into this idea. It's not so much about enlargement of the Western space of liberal democracy, is more about a general state building exercise. So I sense that there is some kind of distance in the EU global strategy towards the aspirations of Ukraine, Moldova, and Georgia. But the good news is that, at least in my view, the strategy does not matter much. Why? First, it's a strategy document, and strategy documents are fine to build a consensus among officials, but if there are decisions to be made, the first step, the chancellor in Berlin or foreign ministries in Paris, other countries, will not be to look at the strategy in order to know what they are going to do next. So I think foreign policy is very much still done by capitals increasingly. We also saw this during the Ukraine conflict, very much so, Germany and France in the lead. So is this good news for the exploration of Ukraine? I'm afraid that I don't come here with a message of much hope, at least in the short term. Because I think what happened is that Russia is actually exercising a control over these aspirations. And 2008, the Russian Soviet war was a kind of, the message was veto over NATO membership, and then Ukraine 2014, the message has been, well, we also don't like the EU membership, because until summer 2013, there was no clear sign from the Russian side that they disagree with the association agreement, DCFTA. It looked as if this could be done somehow under the radar, or that the West would not cross Europe, would not cross a red line, but it has happened. And I think this is perceived not in official declarations, but in big member states as well. We should not mess with the Russians. There's a general sense in Western Europe that Italy is very strong, Spain, France, Germany is perhaps mixed, but the sense is, well, if we don't, Russia is the real problem in this region, and we don't want to have more tension with Russia. We want to have less tension with Russia. And therefore, if we give countries such as Ukraine and Georgia a promise of a future membership, this would again lead to a rise in tensions with Russia. So unfortunately, and I very much disagree with this view, I think the EU should be more ambitious, but the EU member states should be more ambitious. But I think what is available for at least in the short and midterm is a lot of support, but with a view that these are neighbors and not necessarily future members. I think it's great that Georgia still considers the Euro-Atlantic integration as the most important way ahead, because, well, I think reform, economic reform, political reform, stronger defense are goals in themselves. It's not just about geopolitics, getting out of the Russian sphere of influence, it's also building a resilient state, good governance. It's a goal in itself. And I'm glad to see Ukraine and Georgia, and to a certain extent, still in Moldova, that this ambition is there. And unfortunately, there is not a game changer. Which would be a clear new perspective, is not available at the moment. But this doesn't mean that in the longer term, so 5 or 10 years, things couldn't change. The EU is changing, certainly with Brexit. And with Brexit, we don't know, maybe there are new forms of association, something that could be also of interest for Ukraine, Turkey, Georgia, closer relationship without being a full-fledged member. So this is one point, the EU is changing. The other point is, the more these countries become convinced of themselves as liberal democracies, they become more convincing to others as well. And there will be a moment when, well, maybe the geopolitical situation is going to change. Russia may change, we don't know which way. There may be changes on the European side, and then there may be an opportunity. And then if you are ready, we are here, we have fulfilled all your demands, and we are, but we are also convinced of ourselves being there, and then the momentum may be there. So I think it's smart from the Georgian side and the Ukraine side to a certain extent to push for those democracy state building efforts. I'm always positively surprised how strong this is in Georgia. In Georgia, as an example, where this hasn't been driven so much by external factors, but by internal factors. And so it's a really impressive country. And but my main point being that it's good to be realistic about what's available. And it's on the other hand, integration is helpful. Market integration, DCFTA, all this is good. This region can attract more interest. And I think one way to attract interest is also the whole One Belt, One Road, New Silk Road theme, Georgia, the South Caucasus as a gateway to China, and Georgia could play a role in that also in communicating to Europe what this entails, and maybe build some projects and work with the Chinese and the Europeans. So that looks to me a very interesting perspective.
Thank you, dear. The only book would have been very much in my agreement with the hope that I can think that the very key there of the financial security is, of course, keeping alive the post-Cold War rules of international relations and the record of these rules they were taking the sovereignty of the states. And for Georgia, in the period of the time, it's really about putting the sovereignty. So by ignoring the right of the country to choose its own destiny, we are just ignoring the rules, international relations that are the basis for the stability and security. it looks like it reminds of the time and it's going somewhere back in the century. So we hope that the international community will manage to keep the best of the international relations that we have at present. We should not rewrite the history, come back somewhere before the Second World War. So, dear Dimitri, there are really many challenges in the region. I mentioned the increased militarization, especially in the Red Sea region. EU is an actor, and of course, NATO is an actor. What do you think are strengths, military, in terms of military capabilities, enough in the region to keep the security and balance?
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. When I asked the question, I was looking at the slide over there, especially your last remark. So further, your enlargement is kind of part of the question because of internal EU reasons, not so much because of Russia. And I think this is what we have to keep in mind, see, in everything that we're talking about here. It has to do with the EU, more than anything. Let me try to address a little bit your question in the way I sort of thought it out as I was preparing for this panel, the linkage between the global strategy and the Eastern Partnership. And of course, listening to my predecessors, I was trying to figure out if I have anything to say, and maybe I do. Let's look at the global strategy. I'm not the center pragmatic document, absolutely more pragmatic than security strategy. On the other hand, it's deadweight. The security strategy was adopted by the Council. This one is not. This is just acknowledged, and it's basically tells you about the divisions that exist among the EU member states. And you cannot have a new strategy that's adopted by all. So we should consider that. On the other hand, it's a reality check of where and what the EU is about, what it's thinking of doing. But you know, if we look at the security strategy, the global strategy, references to the Eastern Partnership, two. To the EMP, five references. To Ukraine, two references. To to Georgia one. Actually, it's two. One is an acknowledgement of Georgia's idea, but it's one of the text. Moldova, no references. Turkey has 6 references. Russia has 7. China has 5. The Western Balkans 4. A term, because we've talked about terms and ideas that are in the global strategy. One has not been mentioned about, which I think is interesting. Amanda referred to buffer zone. I think the global strategy has a different term, softer term for it. It comes up with a term surrounding regions. Neighboring regions is mentioned twice, and then all of a sudden, surrounding regions, new EU speak 8 times, blurring the lines in that the surrounding regions are the neighbors that supposedly we have an advanced relationship with. And by the way, the surrounding regions is about to grow because Turkey's relationship with the EU is about to change fundamentally from being on the accession track to being part of the surrounding regions, right? So we should keep that in mind. There's a blurring between the two. At some stage in the security strategy, he talks about neighboring and surrounding regions, and that goes directly to surrounding regions. And of course, resilience is important because resilience, again, and I'd like to re-quote, our first speaker did it, but the global strategy describes resilience as a concept, quote, encompassing all individuals and the whole society, a resilient society featuring democracy, trust in institutions, and sustainable development lies at the heart of a resilient state. And I think when it talks about resilience within the EU and resilience outside. And what does that mean? That we're basically going for a hardening of borders and lines. It's been there, it's been happening. And with the EU having launched a soul-searching mission to define its future post-Brexit. And as a consequence of everything that Amanda talked about, that's been happening over the last few years. And we've had this process that started really this year, from Juncker's white paper with its 4 or 5 scenarios to the celebration of the Treaty of Rome 60th anniversary on 25th of March, to the launching of what I think is supposed to be a decade-long process, although I think that's the intention, to arrive at something. And where two models preponderate, a multi-speed Europe and a multi-level Europe. A multi-level Europe, and I'll try to explain it too. For EAP countries, whether the champions, the 3, or all 6, multi-speed Europe is an anathema. Just like it is for other countries, like mine, Greece is one country within the EU. But it's a very real scenario. The multi-level Europe is about something else. It's about a different sort of relationship. While the EU ponders the future and probably goes to a core Europe concept and multiple cores or concentric circles with the existing member states, it also is considering what happens to its partners. So a multi-level Europe also says, well, what role can Great Britain have once it's outside? When Great Britain would say, well, defense, and a few other things. You mentioned energy security. So countries that have a role in terms of energy security will be part of this multi-level Europe, right? And so you're creating, again, a new sort of vision of Europe, trying to keep Commonwealth together. Europe is not dead by any chance. Huh? I mean, if we think about it, I keep saying that we are in a 1950 moment. There are differences. 1950, May 9th, Robert Schuman, Foreign Minister of France, stands up and makes his wonderful Schuman Declaration, reaching out to create something. Today, we're not talking about, we all agree on the need for Europe. This is the acquis. The acquis is that we build it. How we move forward in this. Of course, the big difference is that we think about the founding fathers and today's leaders, the difference is night and day. And I think this is our big problem, right? And at the time of the beginning, the founding fathers were national leaders, right? About 10 or 11, depending on one counts them from the 6 founding states. Today, it's not only national leaders, it's also the leaders of institutions, but across the board, it's depressing. And I think we have to keep that in mind. So in other words, what are we doing right now? It's exclusivist club, which is the European Union, because it's an exclusivist club. It says you want to join norms, values, you have to adhere to certain principles, and once you adhere, you come in and it's inclusive afterwards. And that's the idea. It's very simple as a concept, right? It's decided to become even more exclusivist, to deal with itself, the growing divergence among its member states, growing fundamental divergences,
and divergences in this tug of war, constant tug of war between institutions in Brussels and the member states. And hence, you know, who is running the show? Is Berlin or is it Brussels? And what does this mean? I mean, then this is the reality. And of course, the fact that the core, the motor of integration, France and Germany, is not as powerful as what it is there. But the two parts are not the same anymore. It's tilting towards one side more than the other. And we have to keep that in mind as well. I mean, we think about elections in France, yes, possibilities of Macron with the presidency. Emmanuel Macron, that no one knew about, was going to become president of a key EU member state with no parts behind to back him, no mechanism. I wonder what this means, even though there's no other choice for us Europeans out there. I mean, it's interesting what we've done. So this exclusivist club has become more exclusivist, again out of necessity to try to reduce its differences, and then hopefully at the end of this 10-year process, maybe hopefully less, we'll try to reopen them. How do you do this? Yeah, I mean, the picture is not pretty, and I was, you know, I started getting impressed yesterday afternoon with the last session here, because especially two of the speakers struck a chord, three of the speakers, one is here, I'll mention him, but two of the other speakers were very interesting. So, Tata Boras, really, I love the presentation, because he said that, he says, what do we do? Acknowledgement that this is happening, and the three champions, Georgia, Ukraine, and Moldova, need to move beyond and offer, show that they exist. It's not just about meeting EAP criteria, but maybe he suggested a multilateral approach, that the three work together. And to tell Europe that, hey, listen, we are here, and there's a reason, sort of a proto, or you know, Visegrad 3, that later became Visegrad 4. We exist, this is a vital region, you need to come in, and you need to say openly your narrative is to be enlargement towards us. Great. It's you know, taking charge and saying, okay, I'm going to be proactive. Then we had Ilma Nolan, who was very impressive, because I understand what he's talking about. And you know, as a Moldovan, the reality in this country, where yes, we don't talk so much about Transnistria, but the impact is the same as it is for Georgia, has lost 20% of its territory, or Ukraine's lost Crimea and the civil war in Ukraine, Transnistria, same thing is happening. So the champions are all paying a price. All paying a price for their choice. And so this leads to a serious depression. What do we do? What do we do? And as I said, the surroundings are also getting, the lines are getting blurred. So while we are talking about three countries leading the pact in this partnership, trying to come closer, the EU is saying surroundings, 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 which means everyone's together in the surroundings, whether you're among the leaders or not, or any other country that's a neighboring country. Of course, the mantra, and Carmelissa talked about reform, reform, reform. I think this is what you were suggesting. But you know, this mantra of the EAP, the mantra of resilience, which is about reform. What is resilience about? You think about it. If you reform your state, you make it strong. You make it democratic, rule of law, and so on, and therefore you can withstand whatever pressures out there. The mantra of Greece's creditors, reform, reform. It's easy to say, but difficult to do. And I think this is part of the problem. And even though the EU has had the success, I mean, the EAP has had successes with the CFTAs and now the new prospects of visa free travel for some and hopefully for others. But you know, the people there across the border likes to growl a lot. And but its actions has blurred the lines of the border, right? With its actions in Moldova, Georgia, and Ukraine. And as if its mere presence is not enough, is not concerned enough, the EU is not ready to have a new discourse, a new paradigm. Because resilience will not do, reform will not do. A new discourse saying that, yes, your aspirations will be met. Because the EU cannot, because it's not ready because of its own divisions. And as long as it's not on the card, The AEP countries, therefore, naturally would fall back. Hopefully not. Some are resisting more than others. But we fall back into post-Soviet legacy modes in terms of their reforms or lack thereof, and adopting multi-vector foreign policies, which is a balancing act between the bear and Europe, as opposed to what they want, the clear choice, which is to be European, to be Western, because the West cannot provide. And I mean, in a way, this also answers your question about the hard security. Yes, we're doing it, but there seems to be a lack of vision. I would say also, you know, and I think what this says is that this debate to reconsider Europe, because ultimately Europe does not, the EU, right, I'm using the words interchangeably, does not basically come up with what it is and define itself so it's strong enough to project its power externally. And this is not just for Europeans, not just for the 507 plus million EU citizens like myself, and Ulrich and Amanda and Carlo, but it's for everyone, even the ones in the surroundings, to think about. And I would suggest one should look at two. There have been two wonderful articles written recently by two Americans, both called Landy, about Europe. And I think the answer lies in both these articles. One is Andrew Rafchik, I think many of you have read it in Foreign Policy. Europe is still a superpower. Just came out this month. And Andrew Rafchik, long-term observer of the European Union, puts in, even in graphs, simple things about Europe. Tells a European, look at your damn potential. You are a big force. You don't believe it. Or those involved in EU affairs believe it, but the publics are not totally aware of it. And the other article is by Andrew Mikta, another observer. He wrote it in the American Spectator, and it's called The Deconstruction of the West. And he's talking about, he's looking inside. He says, one of the things that's happened in the West is that the West has shamed itself into calling itself its West. It's not really looking at its history. I mean, it's a dangerous argument that one could say, therefore, you're favoring your return to the nation states and each country for itself identifying its values, but he's talking at a European level, the need to identify values, to be able, therefore, to take a position when it comes to all these key issues and threats that the EU faces. And I think one should look at these two and start thinking and contributing to the future, whether one is within or in the AP region. Because I think everyone has to contribute to Europe. So it's interesting. I mean, yes, it's depressing. On the other hand, of course, the EU allows for this dialogue, and this is good. I mean, even the global strategy was part of a huge consultative effort. And I remember, you know, it's so interesting how things have changed. I used to work at the EU Institute for Security Studies in the past life, and there, myself along with my six or seven other research fellows and our director, Nicole Cristotto, we consider ourselves the pioneers, because we came up with some of the terms of the European Security Strategy, which Solana wanted. It was not a consultative process. It was us, the Greek research fellow, putting away his Greek hat, putting on his EU hat, his German colleague, his Swedish colleague, Spanish colleague, French colleague, sitting together, effective multilateralism, which we coined. And we passed this on to Javier Solana, the high representative at the time, and then the security strategy was developed from our ideas and others. And here we have a global strategy, which is really totally different, a massive consultative effort, right? With the ISS leading a process across many of the countries to consult with experts and officials and so on. But to come to a document where on the one hand there's an acknowledgement of how much interest there is in the EU, but countries kind of come to terms to adopt it. And I think this is the challenge. So we have a lot of work. And so I agree the point about Russia, it's about the EU. It's about the EU. And because the EU does not grow, cannot deal with its differences and divergences, there is, you know, Russia saying, why do you need a new narrative? These guys will never offer it to you. Come back to me because it's an East model. You know all about this model. And this is the real challenge. I'll stop here.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I think we've short time to go directly to the questions for the audience.
Thank you. So the second day, we frequently mentioned Russia when speaking about security. And this is mostly a question of military, defense security, and so on. Today, Mr. Natali mentioned transnational crime, organized crime, human trafficking, and many other problems. What about Georgia? If you look at Georgia when it started anti-corruption and criminal reforms, it destroyed organized crime, especially of thieves and law in Georgia, successfully minimized corruption. And when they adopted in 2006 the law on organized crime and racketeering, meaning that thieves and law mafia bosses, even if they do not commit a crime, and there is evidence they belong to organized crime, they automatically go to prison. After the prison, they may return automatically to prison. If there is evidence, they're still facing law. Therefore, the result was that Georgia pushed organized crime outside of Georgia, because as soon as they're released, they leave the country, and today the European Union countries are full of Georgian organized crime. And then there are massive arrests of Georgian criminals in Spain, they're active in Italy, in Austria, in Germany. And one of the reasons why the visa liberalization was postponed, there was a fear. The German Minister of Interior mentioned the activity of Georgian organized crime. Of course, here is a question: the Georgian government was much weaker than German government in 2003, 2004, 2005, 2006, 2007, but they successfully destroyed the government, that is organized crime. Germany has strong resources, economic, human, and still is a problem there. It's one problem. The second is that when we speak about Russia's influence and what happened in Ukraine, for example, again we deal with corruption. And one of the reasons why Ukraine lost control of Crimea and eastern part was a very high level of corruption. Practically, the army didn't exist because of this corruption, and Ukraine was able to defend itself. Today, again, corruption is number one issue in Ukraine. Yeah. Concerning Georgia, we speak about propaganda, Russian propaganda expanding and so on. But if you look at the reasons, you'll see that poverty and unemployment after 25 years of Georgia's independence still are number one problems according to all public opinion polls. Yeah. And here I have one question. What are key obstacles, difficulties for EU countries when they implement their strategy in Georgia, Ukraine, and Moldova?
Thank you. Considering I don't really agree with part of your notions, but anyway, the question is put it in. And I think the other is very better to connect the two as well. It's a suggestion to be more efficient for us. Please.
Thank you very much. This has been a very exciting panel. I want to focus a little bit on something specific out of this. But before I hand it to Dimitri, who has covered an awful lot in my modest intellect, I cannot really reflect on it much. But there is one thing I want to tell you. In Eastern Europe, Ukraine, there is no civil war. There has been Russian invasion. It's really important to to keep in mind. It has been, it has happened in a covert way, etc., but it is not civil war. Yes, you did. May have been a slip of tongue, but you did. But the question I have is really to the Georgian situation. And that is the
sorry, I said simmering war, simmering. Simmering tension, that's what I said. I'm not trying to think, I know what simmering, I never use the term civil war. But
I it's very good that perfect, because my, honestly, I've heard it the same way as I have.
Okay.
So it's good. The question I have, or the comment I have, is then to the Georgian situation. It's really interesting that Uli had a very, very honest reflection on the Georgian situation. There is one important fact that also reflects on what Alexander just said, that if you compare Georgia's governance indicators to those candidate countries in the Western Balkans, in most of these indicators, Georgia is actually better. In fact, Georgia has a better governance than many candidate countries in the Western Balkans. I can name them, I may not, but it's true. So this is a very strong thing for the European Union, as well as the Georgians to consider in their argumentation. It's objective, you can see those indicators that is that factor on governance. And here, of course, comes in what Amanda has mentioned, that really there is Georgia is in the wrong place for easy integration in the European Union. If Georgia was in the Western Balkans, it would be a very fast integration. So that highlights what Amanda said, that really the Russian Black Sea Caspian's strategy has to be taken much more seriously to improve the geopolitics of Georgia. So that is but also for you as an argument to really look at the governance indicators for the region.
Thank you very much. Do we have any other questions? Okay, from the questions that have on our screen, so I would still put out the question of Ambassador Valery Shvili about European values and could Georgia be seen as a promoter of these values in the region. Let's start the discussion here, Carlo.
Yeah. A comment on your comment, actually. You mentioned before the effective record of the Georgia in stamping out the corruption and fighting organized crime. Georgia did this without the help of anyone. He did it because it was a national endeavor. It was a national, a political, very strong political will. And this brings me to the other question. The difficulties of working in countries of inflation below them. And Georgia, I can speak about Georgia, my practical experience here, 2 years working in this country. Perhaps the difficulty that we encounter here sometimes is to match the level of ambitions and the drive of our Georgian counterparts. Because what we see here is a genuine indigenous-driven effort towards reform. We see a strong political will. Sometimes there is no sufficient capacity to implement the reforms, and there perhaps we can help. But we work together with our Georgian colleagues. But Georgia has been able to make progress in many areas without the help of anyone, sometimes exceeding the achievements that we have made in our own countries, in terms of governance, for example, pro-business orientation of many indicators that Georgia is ahead of what the EU or the EU member states are achieving. So perhaps in paradox, but the difficulty here is to follow our Georgian colleagues in their drive to reform.
I mean, I agree with everything that you just said. I think Georgia is an amazing example where there has been a genuine and honest, you know, commitment to carry out reform for the benefit of the country. I also think that Georgia is a good, you know, it's a very good role model for this region, not necessarily for the leaderships of the other two countries, but for the society, because the more that Georgia achieves, the more it gets from the EU. I mean, visa liberalization is one thing. When you begin to see the results from the DCFTA, when you have a democratic country that has a proper rule of law and all of these values, I think it's something that societies in Armenia and Azerbaijan can aspire to, or it can make perhaps it can make you feel more mobilized in their own countries, because I don't think. To be frank, today the model of Georgia's governance is going to be, you know, reflected in either of those two countries anytime soon, unfortunately. Just a couple of words about the reform processes in the EU in Moldova and in Ukraine. I mean, I think the EU, when it comes to Moldova, was really left with an egg on its face, basically because they put forward Moldova as this number one in the race of carrying out reforms involve an exaggerated way. And this was obviously exposed with these huge corruption charges against the previous Moldovan government, which had been promoting itself as, you know, pro-EU, you know, focused on acceding to the EU-European integration, and all the time they were carrying out this corruption activity. I think this was a wake-up call for the EU not to get carried away with trying to prove that its policies were succeeding. So now I think they'll have perhaps a more moderate approach based on, you know, what the reality were in the countries and what they're actually achieving, and not to over-exaggerate these achievements. And just quickly on Ukraine, I mean, I think what Ukraine has achieved in the last couple of years is actually amazing. I mean, I've followed Ukraine for a long time, and I know many people have said it, but what's been done in the last 2 years is more than what was ever done since Ukraine was an independent state. And the actual challenges that the country faced in terms of, you know, corrupt, criminal, oligarch-linked leadership was massive. Of course, many of the challenges still remain. We know that corruption is not eroded, particularly at the higher level. They've done a wonderful job at lower level, but it still exists at a higher level. And of course, the oligarchs in Ukraine still remain problematic, because they still embedded themselves, you know, in the radar and politics and business through oligarchs. It's far too linked. But I do think Ukraine is on the right track. It's moving forward with the support of the EU, and it needs the continued support and consolidated support from the EU. So it is working there.
Thank you, Amanda.
Georgia is the head of many other countries who are on track for membership, and maybe ahead of some countries who were on track in the 1990s, geography. Hugely dangerous, and I think that was somehow under suspicion, given this idea, you know, take this country and transport it in another location, and just, and the geography for Europe is very important, because geographic, Europe is a geographic notion, and the EU has no clear boundaries, but it's obvious that Moldova is closer to core of the EU than Georgia is, and I think with developments in Turkey, we see a huge backlash, because in the mental geography from Berlin or Paris or Brussels or Madrid, Rome, the South Caucasus comes after Turkey somehow. This is the language to this region. And if Turkey is becoming part of the environment, then it's a backlash also for South Caucasus. That's, I think, why we discussed also the question whether, you know, on the mental map of Europeans, you could put Georgia in a different way, linking it to Black Sea and also teaming up with Ukraine, Moldova, and have just another link. But it's obvious that reform is just one part of EU, attracting EU interest. Reform is one part, Europe is another part, and there Georgia is clearly disadvantaged and needs to be stronger on other governance issues. And then there's the question on the elections, Great Britain, Germany, France. I mean, Great Britain is a different case, but in France, it's obvious that if Le Pen wins, this would disrupt the whole process of EU, European countries, sanctions, trying to put the relationship with Russia on a different footing, and I think also successfully to a certain extent, helping Ukraine get on its feet. In deterring Russia to a certain extent from reverting to use openly military means in Ukraine and other regions. So I think the sanctions have been very important. I think Germany will stay on track even if there is a change from Merkel to Scholz. Because for Scholz, as a former head of the EU Parliament, Brussels is very upset about Russia, because Russia is trying to undermine the EU. So obviously for self-interest, but also of course for ideological reasons, there is a sense that Russia is a threat. Starting with the energy in 2010, Barroso said, but since Russia interfered into internal domestic affairs, trying to undermine the EU, undermine governments in Europe. But this is something that where Europe has really changed its general posture towards Russia. I think this is going to stay in Germany at least, whether there's a change in government or not. Merkel is obviously very supportive to Ukraine and rather distrustful towards Russia. And she has behind the scenes very much pushed for the sanctions and led on diplomacy work with Obama, but also with the Trump government. When she was in Washington, she came out to this press conference with Donald Trump and saying that Trump has endorsed the Minsk agreement, which is quite something. So yeah, there's a strong support from Germany. I can work personally at the moment with the change of government in Germany. The emphasis might change a bit, but as we see now with the new foreign minister, Sigmar Gabriel, whom my Polish friends look to very critically, with good reason, or critically about his Nord Stream 2 activities. But as a foreign minister now, he quickly moved into the position of supporting the overall position of the German government, also with regard to Russia. So I think if this is set, it's the German foreign policy and the sanctions are to a large extent also EU foreign policy which are set. And but of course, if Marine Le Pen would win, all bets would be off, and we don't know. She would certainly not support the sanctions. But it's very unlikely. So this would be a totally different situation.
Thank you.
I mean, from the questions and I think discussion, the issue is not what efforts are being done here or how the EU is helped. It's sustainability. And how do you sustain these efforts without a new narrative? And I think this is where it's all come down to. So Georgia is part of this geography. It's a champion of champions. Can you sustain it? That's all. And we don't have a narrative because we're not ready to have a narrative here, assuming I'm speaking on behalf of the EU. How far can these be sustained when you have Russia breathing down your neck or any other issues happening? And I think this is where we are. What is our narrative to keep our neighbors on, to keep them motivated that there is at some stage accession, and with all the problems that has, that it's even better than today's situation. And I was looking at the last question. So what can the B4C countries do to bridge the gap? And I keep thinking, about this event. And this is an incredible example of soft power. Slovak, through Strathpol soft power, funded by the Visegrad family. Soft power, it's great. You know, the fact that you have had this for 4 years here, and you have a policy debate about the Southern Caucasus, it's showing an interest. It's not an EU-led thing. It's led by a think tank in an EU member state, right? And I think this is what some countries can do, especially the smaller ones, to keep this. Is this something we've lost also? We always talk about the EU soft power, but what can the individual components of the EU do in terms of their soft power towards their neighbors, right? Because again, each country has its own interests, geographic and so on. But this is an incredible example where you combine. I don't think one can do more than that. And whether that's soft power and the fact that, you know, this is on YouTube, it's live, is this, it enhances the debate, not only here, but also in our countries, in Europe, about the surroundings, about another world that wants to become like us. And then we should somehow find a way to do this. So I think, for me, it's all about sustainability. How do we sustain this effort? Because it's been going on. How do you sustain it? How do you keep your population with this mantra that one day it will happen until it starts rejecting it because it's not happening?
Thank you, Dimitri. I would like to apologize once again for the...
But you know something?
You know, my name is not so easy.
Exactly, that's why I said it. We have the same problem.
I think it's clear that yes, there are very great challenges in terms of security in the region, but we have, I mean, the EU and the countries of the region have the same interests, and to work together jointly to address all the threats that really exist. So thank you very much.
And the narrative is not different.
I'm trying to find you.
And then, when I started to teach someone,
I think you don't have the sound.
Yeah.
So I will start this year.
No, that sound does not. So, no, it's up to you because we didn't have a speaker. So, okay, either we can do it, either we can do it with the subtitle. Or
okay.
You can just use
yeah.
The voice. So, yeah. It's not. No, it's not. It's not. It's not. It's not. It's not. It's not. It's
Or maybe you can just how about just one slide in this space and then the sometime and then the camera doesn't you know Yeah, I can just leave it at
okay, yeah, just
the indicator. Yeah, so you can just drop the slide and then you can go back to the
I'm trying to say,
Where
I do, of course. It's just something we have to live with every day, you know. So how about to do it?
Thank you. We tried to call in the people, but we don't have a bell, so hopefully they'll show up.
Yeah, makes sense.
Thank you.
Thank you. The red lines for Russia also for Russia.
Usually, and today, and yesterday, on the speaker, underlined that what happened here in 2008, actually about Russian invasion of Georgia. But I want to remind you that this, let's say, new imperial policy of Russia was announced in 2007. By President Putin in the UN Security Conference. And let's say that Putin was very wrong in his views. Unfortunately, in the West, the Western countries didn't take it very serious. And of course, what happened a year later, the United States started so called present policy, which we saw what we got at the result. But what's happened in Ukraine, with Ukraine? Russia all the time was testing where is the red line. Russia was doing some step, doing a move. Is your red line? No, let's go further. Another step, another move, another move. And you know what's my impression when I'm remembering 2013, 14, after each Russia's move or his move, Russian leader, Western leaders, European, US, they are calling, giving a call to each other and asking a question, why? But I'm sure that the day before doing that move, Putin is asking to himself, why not? This is the difference of that. So, coming back to what happened in 2008 here in Russian invasion of Georgia, of course, the main reason that last year Russian Prime Minister, that time President Medvedev, said that the reason was Georgia NATO oriented policy. Of course, this was the main reason. But I think, I'm sure that there is another reason also, which is not less important for Russian plan Kremlin than the Georgia's NATO way. It was what was done in Georgia and very impressive results of fighting against corruption. This, I think, was unexpected for Russia. Because Georgia showed that the corruption is not a part of their culture. And we know what is today Russia. So-called Russian soft power. One of the main components of Russia's soft power is corruption. Worldwide corruption. Russian corruption is the international syndicate institutes, not in Russia, not only in Russia, in Europe, Eastern and Western Europe, and the United States. So today's Russia, for today's Russia, corruption is not only a source of finances, a source of money. No. First of all, it's a style of governance. First of all. And start to spread this. So speaking about Ukraine, I'm sorry for my colleagues from Ukraine, but the main problem is Ukraine. I think it's not Russia, it's corruption. The Russia and corruption are politically synonymous. And in my country, it's the same for my country. I spoke that about this European and Western thinking, I think it was a mistake. What is another mistake? This is, I think, a point for a discussion. Maybe a lot of my colleagues will not share this position. But I'm sure that the problem is not Putin. I'm sorry to say, but I'm sure that the problem is Russian society. So-called 80% Krimnash, I don't want to translate it. Krimnash is Russian. Putin is a product of Russian society. I want to remind you, please remember 91, 92, when in Russia, European port of Russia, the people were taking down the monuments after communist leaders, Lenin, Dzerzhinsky, but what happened 5 years later in 96? In reality, the presidential elections in Russia in 96 communist leaders. So let's remember that the Putin is the product of this society. The other point. For Kremlin, when West is going to compromise, any compromise, for Kremlin is a clear message that West is weak. No fresh example. What happened in Syria? Just a couple of days before that, chemical weapon attacks, it happened in April 4th, a couple of days before. There were two very important announcements from the United States, State Secretary Tillerson. You know that the Assad is not, the firing of Assad is not a priority for the United States. And I think the next day the same was announced by US representative in the United Nations. The same. After a couple of days, happened what? This is another evidence that this was a message to Kremlin. First of all, Poland, but for Syria. The West is weak. The West is ready for compromises. So, my answer once more, where are the Russian borders? It must be Russia's state borders. But today, Russia is threat for all neighboring countries. Because if you are a Russian neighbor, you have two choices. To be an enemy of Russia, during the visit years, or to be, let's say, a friend of Russia, but mean a vassal of Russia. Today, you know, my country, Armenia is in pro-Russian structures, Eurasian Union, CSTO. In 2013, Armenia was ready to sign the association with EU. But on 3rd of September, what happened? You know, in one day, when President was in Moscow, Armenia made a U-turn in Armenian foreign policy. But Brussels said, I would say, it was the no choice of Armenian society, and it was no choice of Armenian nation. It was not on the part of the nation. So, and a couple of words maybe about the threats to Israel, south of Israel. The main threat, I think, is the military threat. Russia has these plans, the so-called Lavrov plan. This plan exists. It doesn't matter that Lavrov said that such plan doesn't exist. Lavrov also said that since there are no Russian militaries in Donbass, there are nothing happening in Syria. So this plan exists, and this situation in is not in favor of Russia. But Russia will be ready to change this situation. This situation, Ukraine will have more than today. First of all, the Russians will put these groups. And there is in reality, Armenia is a formally strategic partner of Russia. But as I said, the relations are asymmetric. But the main strategic partner in Russia is Israel and South Africa. And so called Russian Lavrov plan, this is something that large. Some territorial gains and creating a situation when even West can apply to Russia, please do there something we cannot do, and Russia is the only conflict in former Soviet Union territory There are no official papers for today Russia. Peacekeepers, solo peacekeepers. Of course, there are other demands too, but there are recently twice the public foreign minister Russia spoke about that. Russia wants to see Azerbaijan as a Eurasian Union. Of course, there are some other demands. But I think what happened in 7th of April in Syria, I speak about the Tomahawks. I think it politically changed the situation now. I think Kremlin must be much more careful. And so, of course, some others. So maybe this will a little bit slow down the possibility of another war. And the last point I want to say that what are the, yesterday my colleague spoke about what happened in April last year in Nagorno-Karabakh. What is my conclusion? Despite of this weapon disbalance between Armenia and Azerbaijan, I want to remind you that according to a report, recent report of Stockholm Peace Institute, in the last 7 years, Azerbaijan received 22 times more weapons than Armenia, which is in their website. So despite of this disbalance was not enough for Azerbaijan to gain a real territorial gains, which is important to implement our plans. According to today's situation, if the next war, let's hope it will not be, but I think there are less chances. If U.S. of course will allow Russia to play, it will be much hard in this limited war to receive that territorial gain because the situation in front line is not what was durable. A lot of changes. What my views to Karabakh conflict first of all? Today, Armenia is trying to preserve the OSCE Minsk group negotiation format, while Russia and Azerbaijan are working to transfer the process to Russia, Azerbaijan, Armenia, China, and so forth. The other two Minsk group co-chairs, USA and France, should not only try to organize little effective meetings of Armenian and Azerbaijan leaders, but begin active talks with each party to the conflict, something which is being done by Russia now. For the time, is Moscow that actively works separately with the parties. And speaking, coming back to West strategy, what could be, I think it was the active restraining of Russia, strategic Russia. And finally, I want to remind you what wrote U.S. President Reagan to Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher after his meeting in 1986 in Reykjavik, Soviet leader Gorbachev. He wrote to Margaret Thatcher, "The Russians do not want to fight. They want to win, threatening with nuclear weapons." Today we have the same situation. Thank you. Thank you, Dan, for an interesting long speech. And I think your presentation would cause a number of quite provocative questions because you touched this problem on quite interesting angles. Now, our next speaker is Ambassador Archil Gegeshita, who now represents Lema Miklas Foundation. And I think he would be more focused on the notion of Russian revisionism, what is it, about its evolution, current stance as well, how to deal with this issue.
Thank you. Welcome everybody, especially the guests from foreign countries and the fans of the call here. And of course, I'm very much grateful to the organizers for giving me this wonderful opportunity to share some of my thoughts on this very important topic of the day. Let me start with by saying that they have been a lot of many revisions, both in history and in modern times, and Russia is not the only revisionist power, also that not all revisionist powers are always adventurous or always seek overthrow the existing order or maximize their powers. In order to really evaluate to understand the revisionist power is really dangerous, we have to look at the scale of the ambitions and the goals they set in front of them. You have to look at their willingness to take risks in achieving those ambitious goals, and we also have to look at the means which they use in order to achieve those goals, whether these means are peaceful or violent. So I think that, especially risk from revisionists, they are more reckless than the other revisionists, and they have a more ambitious agenda, not necessarily expanding the influence in terms of occupying territories of other states, but also to expand their political power by means of changing the rules of the game, the international agreements and obligations, which together make a certain system of civilized and also behavior. I think that if not all, then most of the audience would agree that Russia complies to the features and norms of the aggressive, dangerous, abusive power, which Russia has been proving already more than two decades. If we are considering just modern post-Soviet Russia, not before, because in history Russia also had been revisionist. I'd like to distinguish Russian revisionism in the 90s and since the 2000s. In the 90s, in the immediate aftermath of the collapse of the Soviet Union, Russia found itself in geopolitical knockdown. Russia was really very weak. That decade, 90s, was probably the worst decade in modern times for Russia, against the backdrop of the triumph of the victors of the Cold War. Russia's sense of humiliation, which in that decade took place, contributed to the evolution of a different new type of revisionism since 2000s, when first Putin came to power and also the oil prices began to rise. Especially the second factor played a role also because of the unexpected wealth which Russia would get from this skyrocketing oil prices, would enrich Russian elites and this enrichment ambitions of restoring world power through first consolidating its influence on the post-Soviet space and then extending this influence beyond came to the agenda. This was something changed the new Russian revisionism, and it became even more dangerous and even more risky, something which really hence deterred and even more contained. I'd like now to a little bit talk about the inspirations of rational revisionism, which are the factors which inspire, which feed rational revisionism. I've already mentioned the humiliation in the 90s, which created in rational's sense of necessity of revenge over victors of the Cold War. And their proxies, especially in the post-Soviet space. This is the primary, to my understanding, the inspiration of the modern Russian revisionism. And another factor which appeared later than the early 2000s is that Russia began to perceive the West weakening the global liberal order collapsing, this was perceived as a chance for to expand its power both territorially and also in terms of its access to decision making on worldwide politics. There is one more important circumstance which also inspires Russian revisionism is this the anger of the of Putin personally and those who make the decisions in Russia anger for the ingratitude of former Soviet republics. Former vassals of Russia, because it was perceived that the mother Russia was feeding these former vassals, and these ungrateful vassals now seek other orbits of influence and other settings and other formats and other alliances. So this should be stopped. So this anger is also a source of inspiration for Russia's modern. Revisionism. Another ideological driver of expansion has been Russian elitism, the salvation of Russian compatriots outside of Russia's present borders. Unfortunately, Georgia was the first victim of this ideology. Russia began it with pasteurization in the breakaway regions. So made the residents of these breakaway regions Russian citizens, and then Russia gave itself the right to protect the citizens. And under this pretext, then Russia built a strategy of invasion, and there was fortunately first used in Georgia, and then later in Ukraine. The factor that Russia is a very powerful nuclear state also plays a role in modern Russia's revisionism because hiding behind the nuclear shield, Russia feels to be safe in revisionist sorties and revisionist outings and interventions. Being confident that seriously Russia will not be punished or cannot be otherwise contained. Modern Russian revisionism is dangerous in several respects. In temporal dimension, in time scale dimension, Russian active revisionism will probably continue at least 10 more years and thereafter it will not disappear completely. It may change its features, nature may become less risky, less dangerous, but Russian revisionism will not disappear. In respect of this case, Russian revisionism is no longer living in Europe as it was in the 90s. These days it has already embraced the Middle East. And if you consider cyberspace as well, then it has already acquired a global dimension. And in terms of character, Russian revisionism is both aggressive and prone to risk, and Russia proved it already. And by the scale of the goal, the Russian revisionism is truly revolutionary because it strives to replace the goal of liberal order to break down NATO or other Western land institutions and to degrade American hegemony and to promote the Russian world ideology. So, what are the limits of Russian revisionism and can Putin sustain this type of revisionism? Until recently, Putin acted without an ideology. He didn't have a clear-cut UN ideology. And now he has one. Putin's Crimea speech, which you remember well, delivered inviting him this speech on the occasion of the Crimea and Sevastopol formally joining the Russian Federation, was a political event. More important than, or no less important than, the annexation of Crimea itself. Because the task of Putin during this speech was to legitimize, to justify, or even to glorify the annexation. But he did much more. He fulfilled an even more important task, mission. He created a new ideology for the so-called Ruski Mir, Russian world. No dictatorship can sustain on violence or intimidation alone and for long. A protracted dictatorship needs some kind of ideological basis or a mythology or whatever in order to sustain its dictatorial policies, like, for example, Stalin's ideology of communism or Hitler's ideology of the superiority of German nation, and so on and so forth. Putin claims that it is his right and even second duty to protect not citizens, not Russian citizens, but ethnic Russians or Russian language speakers, wherever they are, all over the world. This is the cornerstone, the basis of the new ideology of Ruski Mir. And also in that very Crimea speech, he put another notion, he introduced another notion, which is the Novorossiya. And by Novorossiya, he referred to eight or seven Ukrainian regions. Which, as the Russian elite thinks, was unjustly handed over to Ukraine after the Bolshevik Revolution. So now Putin has created a long-term ideological system, and he can use to justify his role forever because it is a very long program. On the other hand, despite the existence of this ideological basis, Russia's balancing strategies and revisionism have to a large extent proven to be counterproductive. Why? Because they're not leading to multipolarity. To my understanding, it leads more to, again, to, it reinforces unipolarity. Because the reason is that Russia's powerful, because Russia's balancing strategies have focused on regional revisionism very brutally. In Georgia, then in Ukraine, now in Syria as well, and it provoked a powerful response in Europe to contain these revisions. And the modern version of containment is a diffuse reaction by Russia's threatened neighbors, and it centers on strengthening the U.S.-led alliance system in Europe in order to maintain the status quo. Instead of preventing the expansion of NATO through a divide and conquer strategy or driving the diplomatic wedge between the United States and Europe, Russian revisionism has united or is uniting NATO and European Union behind the United States. So United States is therefore or could be the main strategic beneficiary of Russian balancing, which is likely to lead to a long, hegemony or unipolar moment. And I'll be concluding my speech now with trying to, with an attempt to answer the question, how can Russian revision be deterred? Great power revisionism is a centuries-old challenge, and it has always been very difficult to deal with, not because those who would deal with this problem were incompetent, but because revisionism exploits real vulnerabilities in how states calculate their interests and devise their foreign policies. As long as revisionist states carefully choose their targets and means, there is no easy answer to the problem we face. It will be very hard for Russia now to reverse their revisionist policies. It will be very difficult to reassure them, its neighbors on the post-Soviet space, that now I'm a benign neighbor, I'm a benign partner, don't be afraid of me, because nobody would believe it. So it will not work. And also, secondly, if Russia would somehow step back, then it would be perceived as a policy from the weakness point, which Moscow is not likely to accept. So the bottom line of this analysis is that Russia will most likely continue down her current path of balancing through revisionism, which in the long term, on its own, will only strengthen the U.S. alliance systems in Europe, and therefore the unipolar moment of the United States and its geopolitical preeminence will endure. Russian revisionism and the West dominance, Russian revisionism on one hand, and the West dominance and U.S. hegemony, they reinforce each other. So as long as each of either of these elements exists, then the other will also be there. So my conclusion would be pessimistic in the sense that Russian revisionism, to my knowledge, will last for a very, very long time. But the optimistic element of my conclusion would be that this revisionism will remain within West. Western determined rules of the game and order.
Thank you. Thank you, Ambassador. I think your presentation was very provocative, but one question always comes to my mind when we speak, including listening to your presentation. When we speak about Russian revisionism, it's what it might be in concrete terms. Is it just, it should not be just an irrational desire. Some certain plan and final goal should be behind this. And to form it and to guess it correctly would mean very much for all of us, because the particular model which is somehow formed in terms of concept of hidden, maybe, concept of Russian revisionism, would tell us a lot about what kind of political threats we are going to face. And I think we have to concentrate more on this particular issue to try to guess what it is as a final goal, as a concrete terms, and so on. At least it is most of all important for Russia's neighborhood, including my country. And I think it also, this final goal, forms very much this revisionism behavior and politics as well. Now, our next speaker is a professor from Harvard University, Mr. Andrei Makarchev. And
thank you very much. We didn't coordinate our plans with the previous speaker, but in fact, I will try to continue some of these points that he had already touched upon. But first of all, let me start with the question mark is speaking about limits, borders, and boundaries. It's a very tricky thing, and there's always more than one meaning in this concept. And in my 10-minute speech, I would like to counterbalance the otherwise predominant attention that is usually given to geopolitical explanations of Russian power. And that was quite evident yesterday and in our today's panels. I'm not claiming that geopolitical is irrelevant, no, definitely not. But what I'm trying to say is that this is not the only game in town, that if you try to understand the technologic or logic system of Russian power in general and Russian policies towards specific countries, we need to have a broader spectrum of different forms and models and practices of power that Russia sometimes keep at a very high level of, I would say, intentional uncertainty. Speaking about the kind of inevitability of the Russian, let's say, power projection, while we might have some problems with clearly defining what is all this this about. So again, coming back to this, you know, skepticism towards the geopolitical approaches, I would like to mention that, of course, there are different many other interpretations that do not necessarily that straight.